This house used to be a cowshed, and although it's right alongside a road, the cost to be connected to the grid was spiralling out of control.
There were moments in the middle of the night when we'd think we're building this huge house and we'll never be able to live there because we won't have any power.
But the house is 75% built. This is now becoming a massive crisis.
The building faces due south and is surrounded by open fields. It's just north of the 8th century town of Shaftesbury in Dorset, England. Building work started in early 2018 to convert a large agricultural building into a home. The core structure of a concrete base with steel metalwork supporting a metal-clad roof stayed within the same building footprint, and it was carved up into a large five-bedroom property for Vanessa, Bruce and their two teenage children to live in.
Okay, this is a little bit embarrassing, a bit of naivety, but at the top of the hill, we've driven up and down it for years, there's cable at the bottom, power lines as well, but in between is the bit where the barn is, and our initial thought, we're just off the road, we're not a quarter of a mile down a track, allocate maybe 5,000 for connecting to electricity, but alas, there was none, and it was a good 600 metres away.
So it was a long way to bring cabling, and it was going to be very, very expensive.
The assessed costs for either going over a neighbour's fields, so all the way leaves and things you need, or should that be a problem down the verge of the road, varied from 60,000, so therefore way beyond what we'd been looking to do, to as high as £160,000, which we did not have.
We thought for a good 9 or 10 months that was the only way we were going to be able to have power in this house.
With stress levels at an all-time high and the shine being taken off the excitement of self-building, they made an impromptu visit to a national house-building event in a local city. It was there that they made contact with Ian Hewson from Off Grid Engineering.
I briefly described what we had, but with quite a pessimistic view on it and saying, I'm sure you're not going to be able to help. And Ian straight away said, yeah, we'll be able to help you.
I think often the case is with Off Grid, until it's actually up and running and working, it's people look at it as though it's a little bit like black magic. And they're not entirely convinced until they see it actually in operation.
Ian came down here in the very early days and met our electricians and our plumbers, who were full of doubt. They were complete doubting Thomases and said, you'll never run air source heat pumps and everything off an off-grid system. And after an hour of talking to Ian, I remember Ian left and they looked at me and said, he can do this.
And it was like looking at the scales coming off the air source man's eyes, because he suddenly went, oh, it can work. He threw a lot of numbers at Ian, and Ian was able to field all of them.
People just look at the solar side of it, rather than the whole picture and the storage that goes with it, and really the technology that's available now. People still aren't really aware of what you can do.
That was one of the best moments, and it happened right here in this sort of inner hall.
It was a kind of a Damascus Road moment. It was extraordinary.
So the nightmare was over, and the property can now have the power it needs without the hefty grid connection price tag. Slightly down the hill from the main building was a south-facing field, and this is where Ian and business partner Scott decided to install their solar.
We noticed that on this piece of land here, there was a natural contour in the land where we could sneakily install a couple of panels in these Renusol console tubs. So these are actually made out of recycled plastic, and one panel sits on each tub. And inside we just have ballast, so we can use these for a ground-mounted array, or we could use them on a flat roof, for example, as well. In the UK, if you have a permanent structure, you need obviously planning consent or permission for from whoever the governing body may be. It may be in a national park, or it may be a site of specific scientific interest, for example. So the use of tubs is really useful in the UK because they're a semi-permanent structure. It's not notifiable to planning. It's a very, very low visual impact, and they can easily be moved. I mean, literally, we can pop the panels off these, remove the blocks inside, reroute a cable, and remove these and install them somewhere else, in a day.
But the amount of solar installed isn't the first thing to be decided.
Typically, what we would look at, every situation is different, every client's different. We'd be looking at their peak loads and their continuous loads. So from that, we would choose the size inverter charger. In this case, we went for a 15 kVA Quattro to cover all of those eventualities. With any size inverter charger, you need an equivalent battery bank that's able to feed that inverter charger with enough power at an instant, straight away. So that's a secondary consideration, and obviously we need that battery bank to be large enough to give them a couple of nights autonomy as well when we don't have much irradiance and the solar input is low. And then probably the last consideration is how many panels do you use. A general rule of thumb for me is to take account of seasonal variations in the UK. I'd like ideally to be able to charge a battery bank from almost empty in around about 2 hours.
To do that, Off-Grid Engineering have installed 80 335-watt split-cell monocrystalline panels. They have oversized the amount of panels required by around 30% due to the shallow angle of the land and bucket combination for this location. Four strings of five panels are each fed to their own Victron Energy Smart Solar MPPT 250-volt, 100-amp charge controller in the power room. This is via armoured cable underground within a 10-centimetre pipe installed by the builders.
So we've used the four charge controllers, and they are wired together with a 15 kVA inverter charger and three BYD battery banks. So they're all wired in parallel with the Lynx bus distribution system and fused inside there.
The batteries are by BYD and they are 13.8 kilowatt hour lithium iron phosphate batteries.
One of the reasons we use lithium iron phosphate is very much down to obviously the number of cycles that it can achieve over its lifespan and the warranties that we can place on it, which far outweighs lead and works out cheaper in the long run when you look at replacing lead acid batteries. I mean, literally, you'd have to have a room full of lead acid batteries to achieve the same effect as we did here. It's also the speed that you can charge and discharge the battery, which is a reference to the C rate. These are lithium iron phosphate batteries, which are particularly suited to renewables when you're running on a sun cycle. So the closest C rating would be a C10. So in this case, we can charge and discharge at a C rate of 0.7C. Which means we can pull a lot of power in and out of these 40 kilowatt hour batteries, and it ties in very nicely with what the inverter charger, the 15 kVA inverter charger, is capable of charging and discharging at as well. So the relationship between the inverter charger and the battery bank is really quite critical.
Each battery goes to their own Blue Sea isolator switch and then onto the Victron Energy Lynx distributor via a mega fuse. All three 48-volt batteries, as well as four MPPT controllers, are all wired to the Lynx power-in busbar via their own installed megafuses. The DC busbar is then cabled to the 15 kVA Quattro to convert the power to the 230-volt supply in the house. cooking in the 4,800 square feet of house is via liquid petroleum gas, and an underground tank has been installed at the rear of the property. Even with the excess solar panels, there will be days when the load is high and the light outside just isn't enough to keep the batteries full, especially if there are a number of dull days back to back. To cover that, Ian has installed a Kohler Ressa 20 LPG generator. Ian has calculated the system to only use the generator when absolutely necessary, and with a maximum use of under 10% in a yearly cycle.
When the house is full and the children are here, and we're having numerous baths or showers and two ovens are going and there are two televisions and music centres and all the rest of it, I don't think, is the generator going to kick in? So we live almost exactly as we'd live if we were on the grid. But I suppose there's a fascination now with trying to keep it all from the panels rather than the generator.
To be able to keep track of their system, Ian and Scott have installed a Victron Energy Octo GX, simply because at the time they needed the extra ports, as they had so many MPPTs. All the data is then sent to the Victron remote management portal online.
I sometimes check it when I'm away with work. I might be in, you know, another country on the other side of the planet, and I go, let's just check what's happening at home. And it's a bit of a game, but it does actually teach you, really, you start to analyse exactly how you're using your energy. And I think that's no bad thing. It's not about being parsimonious per se, but it's just intriguing. And I still sort of slightly have the urge to turn lights off in the summer. Of course, it doesn't matter at all. But I think, you know, why burn more than we should? And particularly once you're in winter and you're using a fair bit of LPG, you know, why not try and trim that back?
So over the last 365 days, 7% of the power has come from a generator, 36% direct from solar. So that's solar power that's gone into the DC bus bar and has been inverted straight out into AC loads. And we've got 57%, which has come from battery storage. So that's been stored and reinverted out of the batteries, which is pretty typical. Less than 10%, which is what we're looking for. So we're on 7%, and that's with 1.5 winters included in the data. So it'll probably go down a little bit depending on which time of year you're looking at the overall stats.
By looking at VRM, we can see during the months of March until October, the house purely used renewable energy from their solar. The generator wasn't activated at all until the 3rd of October, and even then it's not been on every day.
We're constantly tweaking and looking at the system and changing the parameters whereby we may engage the generator. And also in visiting site this time as well, we're looking at ways that we can utilise all that excess energy, perhaps for some electric vehicle charging or some extra water heating to make it even more efficient.
We can go into minute detail and see over the past 6 months, the batteries have remained at a temperature range of between 16 and 29 Celsius. You can see the state of charge curve through the summer, where the batteries remained around 90% full for many months in a row. Over the past 12 months, their 26 kilowatts of solar has generated 9,876 kilowatt hours of energy, of which 3,835 kilowatt hours have been used right away, and 6,041 kilowatt hours have been to charge the batteries. If we change to the consumption tab, we can see the generator has created 876 kilowatt hours of their energy for the past year. With VRM being installed, Bruce and Vanessa have full access to as much data as they want. The system updates every minute, so they, as well as Ian and Scott from Off-Grid Engineering, have right up-to-date information. This system has been up and running for 16 months now, and has proven large-scale buildings can still quite easily benefit from off-grid electricity. In the description below is a link to a blog from May 2020, where the house was featured. There are also links to Off-Grid Engineering and the equipment used in this install.
We had to get our head around how it then worked with the batteries, the inverters, having a backup generator for times in winter when we're using more power than we're creating. But Ian was fantastic, and because he's very mathematical, he was very, very clear, his understanding. He went away, crunched some figures, of course this was a brand new project for him, came back and said, totally, it's going to work. And we proceeded really quickly. And for our builders and for so many people involved with this, it's been really, really eye-opening. And for us too, you know, we've got what we wanted by a rather strange route, but it's been, we could not be happier with it.
Friends are always very surprised that we are off-grid. And one of their questions is usually, and are you feeding your surplus energy back to the grid? To which, no, because we're not on the grid. So it takes a while for people to actually understand that we are totally self-sustaining.
Grasp the nettle. So if you're building a house, I would urge anyone, even if they're right next to a point where they connect to the grid, to really consider this as an option, whether full or partial. But I think we've all got to try and do our bit. Our hand was forced, but we're really, really pleased that we've done it.